Good morning to everyone and a warm welcome on behalf of Guntur branch of SIRC of ICI. I welcome today's speaker, CA Subhashini Ganapathy ma'am from Chennai, who is taking the topic amendments regarding charitable institutions. I also welcome everyone to virtual sub-regional conference of SIRC of ICI, Sub-Vignan, organized by SIRC of ICI and hosted by our Guntur branch of SIRC of ICI. And I request our branch chairman to take over the proceedings.
Thank you, Secretary. Thank you very much. Very good morning. Very good morning to all. The trust, it is a very hot topic, actually. For practitioners, this is one area which we can mint money. So I introduce today's session speaker, Subhashini Ganapathy Bikam for the Bikam FCA for the August gathering. Subhashini Ganapathy is the founder partner of the Subhashini and Associates LLP, completed the course of international taxation offered by ICI. She also completed the course on forensic audit offered by ICI and specialist in tax consulting, direct, indirect, and international taxation. Addressed CA in CA firms in many platforms in international taxation, tax-related topics, and accredited faculty for GST by ICI. Also motivational speakers, students, community. On GST, accredited faculty by the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, Minister of Skill Development, Tamil Nadu Government, and ICT Academy, and Department Training, a faculty member in DTRTI, training the income tax officers and officials of the income tax department. Also trained the GST officers on various topics. She is a co-opted member of the research committee of the Southern Indian Regional Council of Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. I was a co-opted member of the SIGASA Institute of the Chartered Accountants of India and committee member of the Society of Auditors Mylapore. She is a regular guest lecturer in many of the colleges in contemporary topics. I started an initiative with the support of the YouTube channel RedPix 24/7, educating the general public, creating awareness on the basics of the Income Tax Act, and now GST for common man, the procedures, the preliminary do's and don'ts. The viewership has crossed 5 lakhs. Congratulations, ma'am.
Thank you, sir.
She addressed more than 15,000 students as part of the career counseling program of ICI and Tamil Nadu government. Extracurricular activities. Best outgoing student both in school and college. A national player in Coco. Very good. State level athlete. Lyricistic for a devotional album sung by Mahanandi Shobana and briefing by Salventer Suki Shivam, bagged a lot of credits at state level competitions in classical dancer and participant in various talk shows. With this, a brief introduction and with all rounder, I introduce Subhashini Gar to the August gathering. Over to you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. That was a very, very detailed introduction. In fact, thank you. Thank you for that. And I wholeheartedly thank the Guntur branch of SIRC of ICI for this wonderful opportunity. And it's not easy organizing a sub-regional conference in December, especially with all the due dates around. And I also thank the participants for being here today, because without you, the session will not be complete. So thank you for the opportunity, both for speaking and for the people who are here to listen. Our chairman actually beautifully started the reason behind why these amendments have come in. So charitable institution is always a kind of, attractive spot for everybody, because apart from our CA crowd or people who truly know what a trust is, the conditions attached to it, and the people who day in day out deal with a trust, for the general public, in the minds of people, if it is a trust, then it is tax-free. You can do whatever you want with a trust. Probably that is the mindset which has actually brought us to this kind of a situation where it is, whenever there is a violation, there is a regulation. So that's how the entire thing works, be it income tax or be it GST or be it anything. There's an organization for economic cooperation and development, the OECD, from where we actually buy in ideas for our indirect taxation, direct taxation, DTAA and all that, international taxation. They have actually done a study about this charitable institutions across the developing countries. And the result is all these charitable institutions are the ones which needs to be controlled and monitored. While the government is actually compromising on the tax and giving so much of benefits to the trusts as such and to the people who are contributing to the trust, it is equally important that they are into the compliance mode. Now the government is actually bringing in the entire nation into the compliance mode. So the voluntary compliance is the mantra which the government is looking into. Again, borrowing the concept from OECD. They say that for all the developing nations, for you to develop, to become economically resilient country, the mantra you have to follow is make compliance easy and make non-compliance very, very difficult. So we've seen, things, what if I don't do this? What if I don't comply? What if I don't file my returns? Today, people will not dare asking all these questions because they know what it is. So you don't file a ROC return. All of us know with 31st December in front of us, we know what are the consequences that we are going to face. So leave alone ROC, be it GST or be it income tax, we know the consequences which we are going to face. And thinking of the consequences, looking beyond the deadlines or the due dates and taking chance of the non-compliance, when we look at the compliance, we feel like, oh my God, let us close this, let us file it. If it is DR3 KYC, it's so easy. So just file it instead of waiting, skipping, paying that 5,000 penalty and all that. So if you just look at all the compliances around you, though the compliances are increasing in number, maybe the kind of accounting and the records which you have to maintain are increasing. Probably we are all forced to a kind of compliance culture, and more so it is applicable for a charitable institution. When the government is so particular with the SSEs, with the taxpayers, with the people who are contributing to the treasury, the kitty of the government, that they have to be correct, they have to be compliant, they have to maintain their accounts properly. It is 200% reasonable for the government to expect the charitable trusts, where the government actually has co-opted, the government actually believes in the trust that, government cannot penetrate all through the nation to contribute to uplift. It could be like women empowerment, it could be children education, it could be nutrition, it could be elderly care, it could be yoga, anything of the charity, the charitable definition. So for the upliftment of the nation, so basically the trusts are the extended arm of the government, where the government looks at the trusts, relies on the trusts with the CSR and other initiatives which the government is forcing on or putting in for the holistic development of the country. So it looks at trusts as an extended arm. And when it looks at trusts as an extended arm, it obviously expects the trusts to be compliant. So this is not something which came in, overnight idea which came in to the government and said like, okay, come on, all the trusts, you will have to come and re-register. No. So this actually started, 4 or 5 years back when the government brought in amendments in the Income Tax Act to say that the commissioner who is approving the 12A or ATG, then it was like 12A. So 12A or ATG has to check whether the trust is compliant with all other laws. So is it really possible for an income tax commissioner, an IRS officer, to check whether the trust has complied with all other laws? It could be PF, it could be pollution control, it could be anything. So all other laws. So, but it was there in the act, may be practically followed, may not be practically followed, may be implementable, may be beyond the control of a human being. But the idea of bringing in regulation into the charitable trusts or the non-profit organizations in toto is not a new idea which came in now. So in budget 2020, our finance minister said aspirational India to boost the standard of living of the people. So caring society, economic development for all. So all these things were the kind of core objectives or the initiatives which the government looked at. And while she duly acknowledged the contributions of the charitable institutions, which are integral part of the economic development, she also said certain changes in the charitable and religious institutions are important to bring in monitoring mechanisms and to make it transparent so that the activities are genuine and the actual benefits are flowing to the people. So this amendment is totally a kind of turnaround for the all the trusts. But once this gate is opened and once we enter into the trusts, then there is a robust mechanism to monitor the activities of the trust, be it the donations it is receiving, be it the application of funds, be it the trustees who are enjoying the entire benefits, being the trustees of the trust, who are supposed to, in spirit, who are supposed to actually contribute to the trust, who are supposed to spend their time, money and efforts into the trust. It is the other way around. So people are being trustees and enjoying a super duper lifestyle, a luxurious lifestyle, which money otherwise should have actually been spent for the development of the nation, contribution of the charitable purpose. So this is the background as to why this came in. And the other end, probably I told you about the violation. So when we look at the black money laundering, which has happened to trust, when we look at the statistics, the numbers are mind boggling. So it's more so, just to give you an example, somebody puts in $1, they buy a Audi car or a Benz or a whatever luxurious car you can imagine. And that car is being used by the person, the trustee. So the entire thing is, this becomes a donation, and it's like, it's a kind of clear tax evasion and a beautiful place or a beautiful avenue for the entire money laundering activity. So this is a very, very small the basic example which I could give for a normal trust, but this thing doesn't stop here. So it actually extends to the level that, the foreign contribution coming into India, which are applied for terrorist activities, all the illegal activities, you name it, everything is happening to trusts, through trusts. And recently, I got an opportunity to share a session with the Income Tax Commissioner of Exemptions, Chennai. So there, it was so beautiful. Actually, he was supposed to give an overview of the topic, and I was supposed to take the same charitable amendments topic, where I really thought he's going to talk about income tax sections and other things. He really brought in the crux, the element of dharma. So he said, once you think, whatever you do, when you put the benefit of the other person, in the forefront, then, everything is correct. So forget about the regulations that you have to apply 85%, 15% accumulation, you have to apply for extension, you have to keep bills of accounts, etc. All these things are regulations which are being brought in, unfortunately, because that spirit, the substance of the charitable trusts or the nature of charity, the benefit of others, is missing in the public. So that probably I would like to quote here, because that is, again, one of the biggest reasons why all these regulations have come in. The analysis of ITRs are like people who have filed the returns vis-a-vis people who have been operating, and the amounts which have been flowing in, which the government had information through the AARs from the banks, etc., and the actual application, etc. The entire thing was a total mismatch. So when I was talking about societies again, so the societies probably is regulated by the state law, and manually, in Tamil Nadu, it is manual, and slowly we are moving into electronic mode. So I'm not sure about the Andhra, Telangana and other states where you have a state commissioner also for the charitable trust. So in Tamil Nadu, there was a bill which was introduced to regulate the charitable trusts in Tamil Nadu, and finally that was withdrawn. So today, operationally, wherever you are, you can fall into three different buckets if you're a non-profit organization. So you can either be a charitable trust, or you can be a society an association registered under the Societies Act, or you can be a Section 8 company. So in whichever bucket you fall into, it is important that you comply with the laws. So as far as the trust is concerned, certain states in the country, they have a local, the state body which is monitoring the trust. And for all others, once you are a charitable trust registered under the Trust Act 1882, the only compliance which you do is the initial registration. After that, there's absolutely no monitoring except for the income tax returns which we file. So there is no other returns, no other monitoring mechanisms of the trust nor the trustees. Let's take societies. So once we take societies, again, the registration is the one thing, and there is some annual returns of change in the members and other things, and the financials is submitted. That is one other external or extra return which you submit apart from your income tax returns. When we take Section 8 companies, of course, the Ministry of Corporate Affairs, we file our returns with the Ministry of Corporate Affairs. That is one extra monitoring mechanism apart from the income tax. So here, income tax becomes the umbrella, the holding point, whether you are a trust, whether you are a society, or whether you are a Section 8 company. So here the laws are different, but income tax is one parent law which governs all the trusts or all the non-profit organizations in whichever bucket you fall into. So now income tax department said, so you could have been registered under Section 12A, 12AA, or 1023C or Section 35. Today, the government says, wherever you are registered, so better do a re-registration. So who has to do this re-registration? So this re-registration process is a process for everybody, every single non-profit organization in India. So irrespective of the fact that however big you are, however good you've been, however compliant you have been, however respectable trustees or legendary trustees you may have, no matter what, you will have to do this re-registration. What will happen if I don't do this re-registration? You will not continue to enjoy the benefits under the Income Tax Act, despite the fact that you are compliant with your own law. If you're a society, you've been regular in filing your returns, perfectly fine. You will not enjoy the benefits under the Income Tax Act. So that is the point. Now, what is the other major change which is brought in for this trusts? So it's fine. I mean, I'm okay to re-register. I did my registration once when I started the trust in maybe in 1960s, 1970s, you don't know. After that, you are asking me to re-register, I will re-register. Can I forget and sit back? The answer is a big no. Your validity, which you've been enjoying all through, since you registered under the Income Tax Act, was eternal. So irrespective of the life of the trustees, the life of the trust, until the life of the trust, the entire exemptions, be it to LA or be it ABG, was there, was life. And today, the exemption which you will be receiving is limited to 5 years. So what will happen after 5 years? What is the government going to do in this 5-year period? The government is going to put clear, robust monitoring mechanisms for each and every trust so that the money which is flowing in into the trust and the money which is getting applied and the money which is flowing into the actual purpose of the trust, the essence of having a non-profit organization, is completely utilized. So in this 5 years, if the government feels, or if the government has enough reasons to believe, I think that is a word we'll have to use, reasons to believe that you are not aligning to the motive of the government, if you are not aligning to the true essence of the substance or the definition of the trust in spirit, then you will be out of the exemption, enjoying the exemption. So that is the entire idea. So today I register. Okay, fine, you're asking me to re-register. Is this process going to be cumbersome? Are they going to call me for a personal hearing? I'll have to show them photographs of what I've been doing all through. Should I actually carry my bank statements? Is it going to be a kind of scrutiny kind of thing? The answer is a no. Most of you would have, in fact, done and, you would have received the registration as well. So registration process is very, very simple. Of course, with a caveat that, subject to the income tax site working in our favor. So it's very simple. It has the basic documents like your trust deed, the financials, the KYC of the trustees. You upload it and it is automatic. So I would probably compare this with our CA course. In CA course, we don't restrict entry. We say if you are 12th pass, you're welcome. Even if you get 55% in your BCom, you're welcome. So entry is open. Exit is a challenge. So that is where the regulation comes in. Probably I would equate it to what the government is doing in terms of the charitable institutions also. So today, if you are an existing trust, already enjoying the exemptions under the Income Tax Act in whatever section it could be. It is asking you to re-register. And once you re-register, the approval is automatic. There's no big scrutiny unless there's something grossly wrong. So we get the approval automatically. And this approval will be valid for 5 years. So what we should do in this 5 years, we should be compliant with all other laws. We'll have to make sure that we abide by the conditions prescribed under the income tax law. We should make sure that we don't violate any of the conditions prescribed in Section 13. We should ensure that the objectives of the trust are aligned with the activities. Now, coming to the objectives again. So there could be differences in the objectives which the trust was started and the trust which is functioning now. I don't question the concept of charity there. So it could be like somebody started this trust with the idea of nurturing children or taking care of children. That was in 1970s. And today, generations after generations, somebody is taking care of the trust. But today, they realize there are so many people to take care of the children. And hardly like, you know, kids are left because people are ready to adopt. You know, so many things have changed in the culture and the lifestyle of people. So taking care of kids is not a problem. Kids are taken care. The problem is with the senior citizens. People don't take care of their parents. So today you realize that it is important that you have to create a old age home or you have to take care of the elders. So your objectives originally when it was started said that, you know, you're taking care of the kids as a main objective. Today you are taking care of the elders. It is not I'm giving a very, very close example just for us to relate. It is not a complete deviation. Taking care of the elders definitely falls within the definition of charity under Section 215. No questions asked. But is it important that I amend my trust deed? The answer is yes. So today, when I said it is robust monitoring mechanism, it is robust monitoring mechanism. So it is not that you are deviating from the definition of charity. It is not that you are doing something for your benefit as a business. No, even if it is charity, even if you want to change the objectives, you know, shift some ancillary to main and main to ancillary, etc. It is time to do. It's one time cleanup activity for your trust. The homework or the to-do items to list when you are entering into this 5-year renewal process, maybe is one, you have to revisit the trust deed. Why should I revisit the trust deed? The trust deed could have so many things which are relevant, which were relevant, which are not relevant, or which may not be relevant with our vision for the next 5 years. So it is important that every trust sits and discusses what the trust is going to do in the next 5 years, because the monitoring mechanism, the renewal process is going to be for 5 years. So our vision should be for 5 years. So what the trust is going to do, who are going to be the trustees, how the modus operandi will be, who will be taking care of the trust. So the trustee who is appointed for, you know, honorary purpose carrying the name as trustee, does he really have the time to actually spend to check, to monitor the trust activities, to ensure that the trust activities are in line with which the government is expecting, etc. So it is time to revisit who are going to be the trustees, who is going to take care of what. So assigning the responsibilities, the place, the location of the trust. So we may be having the trust in some address. You know, when they registered, they gave some their residence address or something, which will be completely different from what is being operated today. Maybe you don't need a place. Maybe you are doing some online yoga, which is also a charity. So you don't need a proper place, etc. It is okay that you do it in your own residence. Perfectly fine. But the address which you are giving in the trust deed should be the actual address. Now, let us take what the Ministry of Corporate Affairs is doing. So Ministry of Corporate Affairs is actually asking us for latitude, longitude, etc., where your registered office is. So we are no longer allowed to be in an atmosphere where we can just operate without a place. So it is important that we have a proper place from where we actually operate the trust. So the place has to be amended, revisited. Fourth is the objectives of the trust. So the objectives of the trust, as I told you, it is important that we look at the next 5-year plan, the 5-year plan of the trust, what we are going to do, how we are going to do, and amend it. And in case if you are going to receive any foreign contribution, we bring in those kind of clauses, which is important here. There are cases, there are situations where the trustees who started, the founder trustees, maybe all the trustees, they are no more, but the trust is still functioning. So again, we have a chance to have a complete revisit of the entire transaction and amend the trust deed. So the trust deed is amended. We have our bank statement in place. We have our financials in place. Now coming to the KYC of the trustees, how important it is. So when we suddenly like something called director identification number was, you know, brought in, it's a kind of similar activity which the government is doing to do in trying to do in terms of the nonprofit organizations. So in terms of the nonprofit organizations, the government wants to understand how many trusts the trustees are associated with. Similarly, you can relate this to the Darpan ID, which we are getting for the FCRA. So though it is not part of the act, though it is not mandated by any rules, law, etc., we are actually going by the Darpan ID. We are impliedly following. So nobody asks why. So we are getting the Darpan ID, and because only with that our FCRA activities can happen. So similarly, this trust is also getting monitored. All the KYCs are gathered to ensure that the trustees are not enjoying any undue personal benefits from the charitable organizations. So here, the every trust is allocated a unique number. And with this unique number, obviously, just like our income tax, GST, etc., everything is linked. This number will be linked to all other laws applicable. So going back to the amendment, which said any charitable institution should be complying with all other laws in place. Now the government is actually putting in place that, you know, to ensure, to monitor that it is actually monitoring and putting in place that you comply with all other laws. So if there is violation in any other law which the trust should comply with, it is reported to them. The system gives a red flag that this person has not filed this returns or it is not complied with this. Now, what happens to the associations who have not filed the society, the registrar of societies, if you have not filed your returns? It is time that you go file your returns, pay your penalty, clean up, and then come here, because complying with all other laws is a precondition here. Now, there's also a question as to the registration of the trust. So when it comes to societies or Section 8 companies, we have no question. So they all are registered. When it comes to a trust in Tamil Nadu, it is okay to have a unregistered trust. I'm not sure about Andhra, Telangana, or other states, Karnataka. So in Tamil Nadu, for example, if I can take, there can be a trust which can operate without getting registered with the registrar office, without getting registered itself under the Indian Trusts Act. So what happens to those kind of trusts? Today, it is important that you get yourself registered. So how do I register this? So again, an amendment deed with the vision forward for the next 5 years, you amend the trust deed and get yourself registered. Now, another question comes, you are asking me to amend all the trust deed. Perfect. We are already registered under 12A, 80G and 1023C, etc. Now, my registration as a condition comes in that any change, any amendment, I should get the permission from the Commissioner of Income Tax before doing any amendment. Perfect. So we were taking practically, like theoretically, if I say that you will have to definitely get the approval of the commissioner before making any changes in the trust. So which is the major change, which is the minor change, which is important, which is unimportant, that probably like is a practical call which we have to take. Recently, when the deadline was not moved, so we felt we can actually communicate to the department. Obviously, we did not have sufficient time to apply to get the approval and then go on for this 12AB registration. So what we did, we just communicated to the commissioner that we are making these changes, and due to paucity of time, we are proceeding with this, and we'll be happy to submit any further information which may be asked for when when you're scrutinizing my application. So along with that application, the acknowledgement which we submitted to the income tax department, we went ahead and filed it 12AB. Now that we have time, probably like we can do it along with the due process. So any change, step one will be permission from the commissioner, step two amendment, step three the registration process, whichever is applicable to you as a charitable organization. So now, as far as the already registered trusts, people who are already enjoying the benefits under Section 12A or Section 80G, all these people can just go ahead and file the form with the respective clauses. So whether you're new or existing and all that, the form is pretty simple. The attachments are pretty simple. And the approval is also pretty simple, subject to the site working. So all these processes are happening. So what if I am a new trust? So if I'm a new trust, earlier the provisions were a kind of chicken or egg story, where you wanted a 12A application, a 12A approval to open a bank account. You wanted a bank account number for a 12A registration. So this was a story. So today what the department says is, you start a trust, perfectly okay, I will give you a registration. Now, how long will I be treated in par with the people who are already enjoying the registration? The answer is no. You will be granted a registration for 3 years. So for this 3 years, you will be granted a provisional registration. The other one is called permanent registration, but permanency lasts only for 5 years. So for the people who are already enjoying registration, who are already registered and enjoying exemptions under the Income Tax Act, they will have to re-register, and this re-registration is valid for 5 years, which is called as a permanent registration. For the people who are starting new trusts, new non-profit organizations, it could be anything. It could be trust, it could be societies, association registered under societies, or it could be a Section 8 company. If you are starting a new venture, a new trust, your trust will be valid for 3 years. I mean, your trust, no, your registration under the Income Tax Act will be valid for 3 years, which is the provisional registration. In case if you feel that my activities, I'm going to start immediately. So I am having my entire team, everything ready in place. So all that I need is to just kickstart. So you first go in for the provisional registration, which will be for 3 years. In case if you kickstart the operation, you want to move into the permanent registration bracket of that 5 year mechanism, it is possible. So when can I move from this provisional to permanent? I can move from this provisional to permanent earlier off, whether if I start my activities in 3 months, if I go full swing in 3 months from the starting the trust, I can reapply within that 3 months. So, after starting the activities, I can actually apply for the permanent registration, stating that I have already started operations in the trust and please grant me permanent registration. Or if I don't do anything in the trust for 3 years, at the end of 2.5 year period, I can apply. So if I don't do anything for 2.5 year period, what is the government going to do when I apply for permanent registration at the end of, the last 6 months, the 2.5 year period? That we'll have to really wait and watch. For all these people who are enjoying exemptions under the existing laws and who have registered for, who have gone into this new regime of re-registration for 5 year period, they will have to go in for a renewal during the last six months, which is after 4.5 year. Now, during this 4.5 year period, what all you will have to do? The cash donations. The cash donations is restricted to 2,000 rupees. So you cannot deal with cash more than 2,000 rupees. So the cash transactions are restricted. So it is reduced from 10,000 to 2,000. We will have to maintain a list of all the donors. So back to the regulation violation statement. In the ITRs, which the individuals were filing, even today people do, they just claim deductions. So they know, if I put in this column, I need not pay tax. So people started filing you know, taking exemptions without actually paying to the trusts. So then the government brought in regulations to say that you have to give the ATG approval, you have to give your receipt number and all that. So we were giving. But again, getting this ATG approval number is not a big deal. You know, it is there in the website of all the charitable organizations. You can just put that number and still claim your exemptions. The government observed mismatches in those things where the trusts were picked up for scrutiny and said, like, you know, this person has given you donations. It was not there at all. So this person has actually claimed donations or exemptions under ATG without donating. So now what do we do? Just like our GSTR 2A to B, now this is external party confirmation. You need not declare if you give the donation. The trust will declare that you have donated. So when I say trust, when we were finalizing the, you know, trust activities, finally we feel that, you know, certain things could not be applied this year and all that, you try putting it as corpus. Now, the government clearly asks, what is the name of the person who is giving the donation? What is the PAN number? What is the address? For what is he giving the donation? For any specific purpose, or is it a general donation, or is it for the corpus? In what mode is he giving the donation? Either it is cash, check, DD, credit card, debit card, in what mode is he giving? What is the amount? Now, what the trust will do after collecting all this information, it has to file a return that it has collected all this information and all these people have given all these amount of donations for this purpose. So as a donor, sir, should I wait? Is there some doubts or clarifications?
No, ma'am, you can proceed, ma'am.
Okay, thank you, sir. So it is... Somebody wants to ask something?
There might be...
Okay, I'll proceed. So, when...
Yes, ma'am, when the trust... proceed, ma'am.
Sorry, sir. Okay, sir. Yeah. So, when the trust is receiving donation, it has to file its returns. Just like our salary TDS returns, it has to file a return and issue a certificate. Just like, you know, our Form 16 and 16A, it will give a certificate that it has filed the returns and this is the donation. And this donation received will get auto-populated in the 26AS or annual information statements of the donor. Now, when we were handling GST sessions initially, people ask, you know, you file this returns, you know, it'll get reflected in 2A, 2A, you have to confirm, then this will be auto-populated and all that. And, you know, people are asking questions that, you know, is this all possible? Even when the finance minister was talking about the returns being prepared by the department and we confirming, we all thought whether this is possible. So similarly, the trust returns and it is getting auto-populated. Again, it is possible. It's not too far. Now, this amendment came in last year and it's just continuing and with all the COVID and extensions. So today I don't have records of all these transactions. So from when will I be supposed to file all these returns, etc. It is important that we advise our clients, the nonprofit organizations, to maintain all this information. So whenever, of course, the government will not come in with a sudden thing, it will give sufficient time, but it is good to have all these documents in place because the monitoring mechanism starts from day one. And whatever approval we are getting this year is effective from April. So it is important that we have all the documents in place so that when this is being scrutinized at the end of 4.5 year period, so we cannot say that you never told me, you never asked me for all this information. So it is important that every trust maintains sufficient information of the donor, the name, the PAN number, the purpose for which the donation is given to, and the amount and the mode of collecting the donation. So all this is very, very important that they are collecting. And then whenever the government asks to file the returns, it can file. Or even if this doesn't come, that doesn't become effective in the near future, at least for this year, you will have sufficient information. When you go in for the renewal at the end of 4.5 years, you will have enough information to present to the government. So it has become so stringent that it will be the third party verification from the trust. They file the returns and from there, you will have to just ensure that, you know, your donations are reported properly and it is coming in your 26 years. So this way, all the trusts are getting monitored. So just to summarize the changes of the Income Tax Act, if you are already enjoying exemptions under Section 12A, 12AA, 80G, 1023C, 35, etc., it is time for you to revisit your trust deed, revisit the operations of the trust, bring in the changes accordingly after getting due permission from the Commissioner of Income Tax, and then go in for this re-registration process. Re-registration process for the existing trust who are already enjoying the exemptions is valid for 5 years, which is called as a permanent registration, and where this five-year period, you will be closely monitored whether you are complying with all other laws. So you'll have to comply with all other laws, all laws applicable to you in whatever form you are, in whatever activities you are doing. There could be many other regulations which are governing you. Any non-compliance will have zero tolerance. So as a non-profit organization, you should be compliant with all other laws. And at the end of 4.5 year period, you will have a complete record of what you've been doing. When you're filling the form, in case if you're a trust who has not filed his, filed their income tax returns for so many years, it is asking for all the opening balances. So it is asking for the corpus fund, it is asking the reserve, etc. So that from here, it starts, just like our GST. So where we give the opening balance, after that our purchases, etc., everything is taken care, it is monitored. So today you are going to give a different number for closing stock, you are caught. Similarly, for a trust, we are giving the opening balances, we are giving the financials. So from here on, it is very, very important that we are abiding by the rules, investing the surplus as in the investments prescribed under Section 11.5, utilizing the trust money properly for the purpose it was assigned to. In terms of accumulation, accumulating the right amount, in case if you are accumulating more, file the relevant forms with the income tax and get due permission. So all these things are important. So looking at with a micro lens, that every single regulations, every single law pertaining applicable to the trust is complied with, and go for your renewal process at the 4.5 year period, which will be a cakewalk if you are compliant with all other laws. If you are a new trust formed now, you can actually go in for a registration immediately after forming the trust, after registering your trust or nonprofit organization in whatever form it is. The registration will be valid for 3 years. It will be called as provisional registration. You can either go in for renewal after 2.5 year period, the last 6 months, or if you feel you have actually started the activities in a much faster way, much quicker way, you want to move on to that permanent registration, you are free to apply it at the earliest. So it is either the start of activities or 2.5 years, whichever is earlier. So the trust deed revamp is one important thing that all of us need to concentrate in terms of the trustees, in terms of the vision of the trust, in terms of the objectives, in terms of the place in which the trust is operating. So this is from the income tax perspective. Let's move on to the Companies Act, the CSR section 135 applicability, etc. So again, the corporate social responsibility, there was a study which was done in 2008. Before that, if there is any questions pertaining to the Income Tax Act, I'll be happy to take, and then we'll move on to the CSR.
Ma'am, I have one doubt regarding this unregistered. If suppose some 12A or 80G registrations were not obtained, there are many organizations who are just registering the societies or trust or associations and not even filing returns.
Yes.
What is their income tax, this thing, ma'am, with regard to income tax, not filing return? So how should we deal if someone comes after some 2 years, 3 years, 4 years to us?
So here I can visualize two situations where somebody started a nonprofit organization. They did not even get a PAN, but they've been dealing with bank. So today all this KYC, et cetera, is important in the bank. So you cannot go and open without a PAN number. But the situations which you are talking about, maybe they started this in 2010 or 11. Where the KYC norms were not so strict, and it was operated. In fact, like we saw a case where the PAN number of the trustee was given for the PAN. So they didn't even have the mechanisms of that, you know, the letter T in the PAN to monitor. So all that is definitely there. So if at that kind of a situation, it is important that they get the PAN number first. And if there is, you know, operations in the trust beyond the limit, so it is important that they have to disclose this. And probably there is no kind of macro one situation or one solution to this. Probably case to case, we'll have to take, analyze what they have done till now and to, you know, make sure that, you know, how we can help them to accumulate this funds in the new trust, which is registered under this new regime, and also transfer all those funds and operations so that it moves on seamlessly. So this, for this, actually, this is a little kind of complicated case. Probably I'll be able to support you with more details if these kind of cases are there. If it is a scenario where they have a PAN, but they have not filed their income tax returns, maybe a situation where they have very, very minimal income, which, you know, less than 2.5 lakhs, so they don't have to file their returns and something like that, then you can actually make a financials, report the operations, bring in the opening balance, go in for the approval. For this 12AB, of course, like there are case laws in 12A, you know, where it'll have its retrospective effect subject to, you know, so many things, but we have, case laws and other things in favor of the SSEs for us to comfortably argue and take. So 12A regulations is okay. So it is okay to assume that a trust has a 12A, provided that you do this re-registration process, you do all the financials, etc., and do this re-registration process correctly, provided the trust has been genuine, it has been operating correctly. So it is not that, you know, this is a kind of cleaning activity, as I told you. They have been doing mistakes, perfectly okay, but somewhere they will have to correct and fall into the track. So that is the idea. And we as professionals, we can definitely help them come back to the track, however they have been, provided they are willing to support and travel with us, listen to us, and come into the compliance mode from now on. Hope I have answered your question, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, is there any chance to, not paying tax, if anybody wants to donate any land to the trust now? The excess reserve value is taxable.
Sorry, sir?
A person is donating a land to the trust, man, registered trust.
Okay.
Now the act is changing now. The SRV value to be taxed in the hands of the trust.
Yes.
Is there any chance of getting out of this taxpayer?
Yeah, of course. Like it will be a receipt in the hands of the trust, but that doesn't mean that they have to pay taxes. So they will have to account it properly that it has come. So this is again a kind of regulation where, you know, you have some asset, you want to put it in a trust. Who are the trustees in the trust? Me, my husband, my brother, my brother's wife, and all that. And so we continue to enjoy the trust, and my unaccounted asset becomes an accounted asset. So it is only a kind of regulation to monitor that. So, but if it is a proper donation, then we'll have to do, and obviously like trusts are not taxed. So if there's any other questions, I'll be happy to take in terms of the Income Tax Act before we move on to the CSR and FCRA.
No questions, please.
Okay. All right. So I'll proceed. So in terms of the CSR, again, there was a study which was done in 2008 where all the companies which were supposed to comply with the conditions, the reporting mechanisms, maybe 30-40% of the companies executed it through their own organizations, and a few through the implementing institutions, and all these trusts and societies, if we take, it was hardly like 2-3%. So when they brought in the CSR amendment rules, they felt like, okay, it can be operated only through a Section 8 company and all that. Then there were representations made. So today, any organization, if they are registered organizations, and if they file the form CSR 1, they can enjoy the, or they can be a instrument. They can be instrumental in implementing the CSR activity. And from the company's perspective, with all provided they fulfill all the conditions of the turnover, the net worth, etc. Suppose, I mean, the committee, if they have any independent director conditions, then they have to fulfill all that. And what is the condition that the trust can execute it through a trust or a society? So if it is a trust or a society or a Section 8 company, provided they file their form CSR 1. So that is where I said, like, the registration is mandatory, because there it says the registration is mandatory. You will have to get yourself registered. And this CSR funds, the committee which is organizing, or the committee which is looking at implementing the activities of the social corporate social responsibility, the conditions are, of course, like, it should not be for the benefit of the employees. It should not be for their own benefit. It should not result in any kind of marketing activity for the company. So a company actually decided in a CSR activity where it will create employment for people. So it said, like, you go sell my products and you take this margin. So that is indirectly a kind of marketing activity which the company is doing to promote its own products. So there are conditions under the CSR which you can actually put your funds into. So once you put your funds into, what are the conditions that you want to outsource it to a trust? So there are ways where the company can actually implement the CSR through a trust which is formed by a company, or collectively by 2-3 companies in that area, or maybe through another trust which is operating. So if it is going to invest the funds or route the funds through another trust which is operating, the conditions is you will have to monitor the activities of the trust for the last 3 years. If these activities of the trust is aligning with the activities of the company, the CSR committee, then this can be implemented through this particular trust. And there is a mechanism, again, like the report, the study which I said. So what is the effect? So the effect study is also important, that impact study, probably the impact study has to be done. And there are limitations of for which you can pay the fees, the 5% of the entire total project cost, etc. So you have ceiling. So the impact study has to be done if it is beyond a certain limit, and that has to be reported. So as far as the CSR activities are concerned, if you touch the threshold limit of the turnover or net worth or profit, you will have to abide by the CSR. In case if you are not able to spend that 2% this year, if you feel that your particular project is going to spread over 2 years, 3 years, then you'll have to bring in or project the project and do the reporting accordingly. In case if you feel that you have spent more than 2% this year, then you can actually utilize the excess next year. And in fact, there one interesting study also says that there were people who were spending more than 2% when there was no regulations. Once the regulation comes, they also restricted themselves to this 2%. So for a corporate social responsibility, again, when we look at trust, they say, like, will we get any CSR funds? Can you, arrange any funds? Because once it is trust, it's all about, 1,000 crores, 3,000 crores. We feel like it is all ready. It is waiting in the gates of the RBI. Just one letter or one certificate, the money will just flush in. And all these things we keep listening to. We know how practical and how thing it is. So here, as far as the CSR is concerned, the conditions are, once you touch the threshold, you will have to spend that amount. In case if you're not able to spend that amount, then you have to do this reporting accordingly. In case if you you feel that you cannot spend this amount at all for this purpose, then it has to be transferred duly to that particular fund. And it can be implemented through the registered trusts, registered societies, registered Section 8 companies, provided you file your CSR 1 form. So the CSR amendment rules is one other area where the government is bringing in control and regulations, so that the non-profit organizations are monitored. Because apart from the individual donations, etc., the CSR activity is gaining importance. So there it is more a kind of regulated, where the government can ask for impact study. So which is the, suppose somebody has adopted a village for education. So what is the amount of, what is the impact which the CSR fund has created? So the amount of investment has created in. So that way it is easy monitoring. And Ministry of Corporate Affairs, of course, like once we do the filing now, there is, you know, lots and lots of monitoring, regulating mechanisms in terms of the CSR activity. So we'll move on to the FCRA amendments. FCRA, the Foreign Contribution Regulation Act, is a kind of, you know, draconian law in terms of, you know, the foreign contributions. Of course, with all the violations, with all the money laundering, which has happened in terms of the FCRA, inside FCRA, outside FCRA, within the framework, you know, whatever it is, the analysis made by the Ministry of Home Affairs has brought in this regulation again, where you are thoroughly monitored for every single rupee which is coming into your trust. So if you could be like any form of organization to get a FCRA registration, and the amendments which are applicable now are, you will have to open an account in the New Delhi branch of State Bank of India. So why this came in? So we had different bank accounts. We were operating separate bank accounts exclusively for FCRA. And the banks were also reporting this money that is being received by the trust, which is lying with the trust, which is applied by the trust, etc., to the Ministry of Home Affairs. But having said all that, still there were like a lot of differences and deviations from what was intended to. So here, now the government said, we will keep one single gateway for India through which all the funds will flow in. So once you open a branch in this New Delhi branch of State Bank of India, does it mean that I have to close all my bank accounts which are connected, which are reported, which are informed through the Ministry of Corporate Affairs? The answer is no. So I may have sentimental reasons attached to my bank. I may have comfort in dealing with a bank. The act does not touch that, but there is an indirect catch to it. They have actually capped the administrative expense ceiling to 20%. So if you are receiving $100, it is only 20% that you can spend towards your administrative expenses. So 80% of the funds which are being received for your trust should be spent for the specified objectives. So when I say administrative expenses, what are those administrative expenses is again a question. So if, what are the administrative expenses? In the normal parlance, we'll say like, yeah, it is the office rent, it is the, you know, the manager's salary, it is the accountant's salary, it is the telephone expenses, it is the travel cost which we spend. Maybe it's the food and other staff welfare expenses. All these are administrative expenses in the common parlance. Let's imagine a trust which is into agricultural research. So when you're talking about agricultural research and creating awareness with the farmers, you look at the impact or you look at the expenses, the P&L, the expenditure pattern of the trust. It is just going to be food and travel and stay. So when you look at the face of it, the food, travel and stay will look like administrative expenses. So will this be monitored? So how am I going to say that all these expenses were spent for my objective and all these were not administrative? So if they're going to cap this at 20%, my work, my entire job itself is to do agricultural research. I will have to spend the $100 there. So in these cases, we will have to bifurcate. So will this also be classified as administrative expenses? Will this also fall under 20%? The answer is no. But you will have to have sufficient records, sufficient information to say that these particular expenses were actually for the core purpose, the core objectives, and these were not for general administrative purpose. So in case if you have a person traveling for administrative purpose, maybe for filing your income tax returns and you're booking that expense, that will be classified as administrative expense. In case if you have any expenditure relating to the research scholars who are actually implementing the core objectives of the trust, then that has to be classified accordingly. So ultimately, it boils down to the records which we are maintaining and time to revisit the trustees also. So when I said time to revisit the trustees, when I was talking about the Income Tax Act there, I said like it's important that we have to find people who will be responsible, who can spend their time, who are alive, who are associated with the trust, who are traceable, because we need to give their KYC, etc. Here, they have put a restriction that you cannot have an IAS officer as part of your trust, because Ministry of Home Affairs and the foreign contribution is a very, very sensitive area where the connects, probably the position, the influence, give room for various kind of manipulations which the government wants to regulate. So if you have any person who is related to the government, any principal officer in the government, it is time for them to step out from the trust so that you are compliant with the FCRA law. The next cap is this administrative expense. And not to digress, I was talking about the bank account opening. So we will have to have one single gateway, the State Bank of India, New Delhi branch. We had a mad rush of people. I mean, we were really undergoing tough time opening the account with the State Bank of India, New Delhi branch, without which you were not allowed to file your annual returns. So it was all kind of jam-packed and we were honored. And why this regulation again? Because of the reporting of different banks and the mismatch of the applications in the quarterly returns and the annual returns filed by the people who are registered under FCRA. So every single dollar or every single euro, every single foreign currency which is coming into India as foreign contribution has to come through this SBI account. So when I said, should I actually close all my other accounts which I am operating? The answer is no. You can still continue with all your accounts, but the catch is your administrative expenses capped to 20%. So in case if I'm having multiple banks, multiple branches for convenience of operations, maybe my trust has operations all over India, and maybe in certain villages there are only Karur Vysya Bank, just for example. So I need to have an account there to operate. Obviously, like cash transactions are banned, so I need to have a bank account there in the local bank who will give me good service. So but the challenge here is the administrative expense is capped to 20% and your bank charges will easily fall into this administrative expense. So you will have to take a call. You will have to do a financials projections to understand whether this administrative expense is worth. So whether having so many bank accounts is really worth, despite the fact that you are reporting, despite the fact there is no bar in having many number of accounts. This is one fact which you have to consider while doing your budgeting. Because all your administrative expense, being be it your trust salary, be it trustees remuneration or any administrative expense, if I can say so, should be capped only to the extent of 20%. The next major amendment in FCRA is the donations transfer. So earlier, it was allowed for a FCRA registered organization to donate to another FCRA registered organization. Let's say like I have a trust, my brother has a trust, my sister has a trust. So all the three organizations are registered under FCRA. So we have FCRA registrations, we are regular in filing our returns, our registration is active, all that is fine. So, but I have connects with foreign countries, people are willing to donate to my trust and not to my brother and sister's trust. What I do, I receive the foreign contribution and I distribute. I donate it to my brother's trust. I donate it to my sister's trust, which was allowed. Now, that is not allowed. Despite the fact that the other trust is registered under FCRA, the funds to the trust are being monitored under FCRA. The funds which is received by the other trust will be reported to the FCRA. No matter what, that is not allowed. So if you are going to receive a fund today as a trust from abroad, it is important that you need to have a FCRA registration. You will have to keep accounts for every penny spent. You will have to account for the 20% administrative expenses. You have to ensure that the 80% is spent towards the objectives of the trust and submit your quarterly and annual returns duly. So there are situations where amounts incorrectly come into the current account instead of this FCRA designated account. The actual things, practically we will feel like, okay, why can't we transfer this amount directly to that FCRA account and close it? But it will become a violation, and it depends on the stand or discretion of the officer who's dealing with it. So better to send this money back and receive it only in the FCRA designated account. Next is the annual returns. If every non-profit organization registered with FCRA has to file its annual returns, and renewal process, of course, that started in, that is every 5 years, you'll have to renew your FCRA account. And annual returns are important. And annual returns, if you miss filing your annual returns, the penalty is 5% of your gross receipts. Imagine somebody has got 1 lakh rupees as foreign contribution. Their administrative expense cap is 20%. And they will have to pay 5% penalty out of this 20% for non-filing of returns. And it is not that, you know, you will get a notice that you have not filed your annual returns and the penalty is 5% and all that. The catch is at the entry point. So when you're filing your annual returns, it will say, please pay this penalty. Only then I'll allow you to file your returns. So there is no other way. You will have to pay the penalty and then file your annual returns, because the next catch is if you don't file your annual returns, they can cancel your FCRA registration. Once your FCRA registration is canceled, all of us know how difficult it is to go in for a renewal or a reviving process. So today, all of us are crying for the GST revocation, and despite all the amnesty schemes, etc., still there are like a lot of issues. But I would say GST revocation is just 10% difficult. So FCRA is 200% a challenge, where you'll have to desperately prove that all your records are correct, etc., to revoke and give proper reasons to ensure that your trust is being very, very genuine, and it is worth, you know, giving this revocation, that it will be for the benefit of the nation. So we obviously cannot afford losing our registration or our approval, FCRA approval, which will automatically get rejected. Automatically we'll be thrown out of the registration if we don't file our annual returns. So the check is there. So certain situations where we have encountered, the officers are taking stands that they will take 5% on the gross receipts. So it is like FCRA registered trust maybe is getting 20% contribution from foreign countries, maybe 80% from India. So they are extending, though it is not specifically given in the law as to the FCRA funds or otherwise, they are taking a liberal view that way, that they will make this penalty as gross receipts of the trust, of course, like which is not practically possible. We can definitely fight it out because FCRA law is pertaining to the FCRA contributions, but just putting this as a word of caution that the officers are taking those kind of views as well. So as far as the FCRA amendments are concerned, time to revisit the trust deed. If you have any government officials in your trust, time for them to step down so that your trust is compliant with the FCRA law. You will have to file your quarterly returns. You'll have to file your renewals. The administrative expenses are capped at 20%, and a FCRA registered trust cannot donate to another trust despite the fact that it is registered under FCRA. Any funds which is coming into India through FCRA can come only through the State Bank of India, New Delhi branch. So today, that this is the sum and substance of the amendments which I wanted to take you through. I'll be happy to take up any questions if there is.
Ma'am, is there any limit of beyond any threshold limit, ma'am, to obtain FCRA registration? Or even if single dollar is received also, you should obtain?
Single dollar also you should receive, sir. You should obtain registration.
Okay.
It's not like our GST, 20 lakhs, 40 lakhs, nothing.
So if suppose any trust is receiving from NRO or NRE accounts, then what is the position, ma'am, if they don't have FCRA registrations?
If that will be a violation again from NRO, NRE accounts, again, if it is connected, if it is from a person from India, then it is okay. A foreign contribution should be from a person who is not connected to India. So if a person who is connected with India, it's fine. If it is a complete violation of, I mean, if it is from a foreign person, if it is the foreign contribution which is received without a registration, then that is a very, very serious violation.
That means if we are receiving from non-resident Indians, it is fine, ma'am?
It is okay. It is okay.
So FCIR is only for foreign citizens?
Foreign, yeah.
Okay. And you told that you cannot transfer to other trust. Is it with only FCIR or even without any? To any trust they should not do?
With any trust they should not do before also, sir. Before this amendment, they were allowed to do. If I am registered under FCRA, I am a trust, you are a trust, you are also registered under FCRA. Before amendment, the provision was I can donate to you, you can donate to me. But if somebody else, if Ramesh has got a trust, he is not registered under FCRA, both of us cannot donate to him. That was completely banned. But today, even if you are registered under FCRA, I cannot transfer money to you. Whatever money I receive, I have to spend, I have to account, I have to report with a 20% cap of administrative expenses.
I have another question regarding CSR 1, ma'am.
Yes,
can
sir.
You just tell a few of this thing in detail about CSR 1, ma'am? Who should file that and what are the things in what should be filed? Is it a one-time activity or a regular activity?
CSR fund from again, it's a kind of registration which the government is opening to bring in people. So it says, as I told you, the monitoring mechanism was difficult. So now they say like MCA probably is a kind of easy way to monitor all the organizations. So it says you file the CSR 1 form. Basis the CSR 1 form, we will have a database through which we will give it to the company. And basis this, they can choose the organization through which they want to donate to. And the CSR 1 form is very, very simple, sir. Pretty simple. As long as you have all the documents in place, it will ask for all common basic information as to when the trust was registered, who are the trustees, the trust deed attachments and all that. So very, very simple form. But the thing is, before filing this form, both the re-registration forms, Form 10B and the CSR ones, all are very, very simple. But the forms are simple, but just that the homework which you have to do before filing this is complicated.
So CSR 1 should be filed by the trust or by the company, ma'am?
By the trust, sir.
Okay.
By it is trust. Like the company will have funds. So the company which is fulfilling the conditions under Section 135, let's say like they have a 100 crore fund. Now this company has to select how they are going to spend this 100 crore fund. If the company has a 100 crore fund designated for the CSR activity and it decides that it will spend for children's education. So the company has options like either it can spend through a institution which is authorized to do so, or it can spend it through a Section 8 company which is formed by its own, a kind of extended arm. It can spend through any unknown organizations, any unknown trust activities. Let's say like if I have a trust which is already into this child care activities, child education activities, skill development activities, I can jolly well give this to them and say like you give all the accounts to me. So that also I can do. So in this scenario, where for the company to select how I am going to deployment, so how to whom I am going to give my funds to spend, they need to have a database. So this is a database of just like our empanelment. So we say like we are all there for empanelment. Then person who is assigning the tasks assigned to us. It is similar to that. All the trusts, all the nonprofit organizations has to file the CSR 1. It is a kind of empanelment for eligibility to spend the CSR activity, CSR funds.
Okay.
So if there's any other questions we can take up, I think people are also busy with their annual filing due dates.
Yeah, hello. Hi, Subhashini. This is Sudhakar here.
Hello, sir.
I have one query regarding the point which you discussed now.
Yeah.
You mentioned that all these have to file the CSR form to get the empanelment. So if there is a company which wants to route its CSR activities through some other trust which doesn't file the CSR form, is it still fine or how it will happen?
No, it's not fine. it has to select through the ones which are which have filed the CSR1 forms, which is in the list. Of course, it has things to select from this, but out of this, it cannot do.
It cannot claim that as a CSR activity or CSR thing, correct?
It will not be like a proper implementation. So the proper implementation is through accredited implementing agencies, and accredited implementing agencies are the ones which are filing the CSR1 form.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you for the question.
I have one question regarding the ITR file, ITR filing. Everybody is having that, I think. While filing ITR 7 educational institution, regarding educational institution, that says the criteria for 1 crore below, you need not pay any tax. ITR 7, what we have to disclose, either gross receipts or net income, ma'am?
So this again, thank you for bringing this question. In fact, I missed mentioning this in my points when I was talking about the Income Tax Act. Earlier, people were enjoying both 1023C and 12A exemptions.
Yeah.
So there was no restriction. But today, they say you decide for yourself whether you want to go to that 1 crore 1023C route or you want to take 12A exemption, depending on what activities you are going to choose. So it is a thing that we have to sit back and choose and then file the forms for when we are going for this re-registration. And regarding this ITR, sorry, sir, can you please explain your question? The moment ITR, you started, I got this
ITR 7, in ITR 7, while we are, access within 1 crore criteria, you need not pay any tax.
Correct.
So in filling, I have to show whether gross receipts or net income.
You have to show gross receipts, sir.
Only gross receipts I have to mention.
Yes. Yes.
Against 1023C subclause 3AD.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Only gross receipts.
Gross receipts.
Okay. Thank you.
If there are any other questions, we can
continue. No more questions, ma'am. The chat box also is playing.
So I thank the Guntur branch for this wonderful opportunity for being here today.
Yes. Thank you very much, ma'am, to be a part of this program. Shubhashni
Subramaniam.
Secretary, please go for a vote of thanks.
Yeah. Before proceeding to vote of thanks, I would like to remind everyone that there is a session in the evening at 5 p.m. by CA Ganesh Prabhu Balakumar, sir, on recent amendments in GST. I request, in spite of a busy schedule, please don't miss this seminar, because there are a lot of changes with effect from 1st January 2021, which is affecting the business style itself. There are many changes with regard to especially government contracts or governmental works. So because it will impact each and every one of our client businesses. So please ensure that every one of you attend the session and utilize that also. It was a wonderful session, ma'am, and you have an excellent grip on the charitable institution subject, ma'am. And you are a multi-faceted chartered accountant. We have gone through your profile, ma'am.
Excellent kabaddi player.
Yeah. In fact, people say that CAs are restricted to only acts. But you are multi-talented and you are all-rounder, ma'am.
Wonderful.
Wonderful to see you, ma'am. Thank you so much for accepting our invitation within very short time. And you have delivered a good lecture, ma'am. Thank you very much. I also thank all the participants for attending this first session and utilizing this opportunity. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. I thank the Guntur branch. Thank you all.